Welcome. My name is Vignesh Narayan Swamy. Today, I'll be providing you an introduction to deep learning. In this module, we'll start by defining and identifying the main components of a simple neural network. Next, we'll discuss the concept of backpropagation. Neural networks are a powerful modeling technique that have far-ranging applications ranging from autonomous vehicles to language translation. In a biological context, a neural network can refer to the way that our brain processes information. In our context, when we refer to neural networks, we're describing artificial neural networks, a machine learning technique that is loosely modeled after the human brain's neurons. The following are examples of deep learning use cases organized by data type. We might analyze emails and chats from a customer support database to detect the most common issues that customers face. Or using audio data, we might identify whether a person is under distress by analyzing recorded phone calls to a hotline. With stock price data, we might determine price trends, detect anomalies, or assess risk. We could also get insight into preventing fatalities based on data collected from car sensors. The following are examples of deep learning use cases organized by algorithm type. If we are performing classification, we might examine images to see if they contain a horse, or analyze emails to see if they are spam, or perform fraud detection with credit card transactions. If we are performing clustering, we might look to see if two sounds are similar or if two documents belong to the same topic. And finally, we might use recommender systems to see if a customer looks like they are going to stop using a service based on their web activity. The figure below is a single-layer feed-forward perceptron. This is the simplest type of neural network. A neural network has the following components: inputs, weights, summation processor, activation function, and outputs. We'll go through these each individually in the next few slides. Note that in the diagram, the input nodes, xi, weights, wi, and output are all each a scalar numerical quantity. For example, a number like 0.2. The inputs are what we feed into our neural network. These are often drawn as nodes. On the graphic, these are the blue circles you see on the left-hand side. These nodes either represent features or observations. If we input our features, we'd have one node for every feature in our dataset. So if we had 100 features, we'd have 100 nodes. Alternatively, we could have one node for every row or observation in the dataset. Each input is multiplied by a corresponding weight. The weights are initially set with some arbitrary or random value and are updated during the model training process. The summation processor is what combines all of the inputs and their corresponding weights. It simply adds together the weighted sum of inputs. For example, x1w1 plus x2w2 plus x3w3 for all inputs and their corresponding weights. The activation function transforms the weighted sum of inputs from the summation processor out to the prediction. In later slides, we will discuss more complex neural networks. In these more complex networks, the output from the activation function can go to the next layer in the network. However, in our simple perceptron, the output from our activation layer goes straight out to our prediction, since there are no additional layers in the network. There are many activation functions, including ReLU, sigmoid, tanh, and softmax functions. A linear activation function can only represent a linear function from inputs to outputs, and therefore, activation functions are normally nonlinear in some way to allow nonlinear functions to be learned. The output of the perceptron is whatever our intended output of the network is. In a classification problem, this will be a probability. And in a regression problem, this will be a continuous numeric variable. The single perceptron we examined earlier is a neural network with a single neuron in a single hidden layer. Deep neural networks are artificial neural networks with more complex architectures that call for use of multiple layers. Instead of the activation function passing its output directly to the output, it passes its output to the next layer in the network. One common advantage of multiple layers is that deeper neural networks can learn features at different levels of abstraction. For example, if you train a deep neural network to classify images, you may find that the first layer will train itself to recognize very basic things like edges. The next layer may train itself to recognize collection of edges, like shapes, and the next layer may train itself to recognize collection of shapes, like eyes or noses, and the next layer may even recognize higher order features, like faces. Multiple layers are much better at generalizing because they learn all the intermediate features between the raw data and the high-level classification. Generalization is the process of the network applying learning from the training phase to a new set of data. Let's discuss the next section on backpropagation. A neural network is born ignorant and builds on itself to get smarter and smarter. It starts out with a guess for the weights and then tries to make better guesses as it learns from its mistakes through backpropagation. In the following slides, we'll talk a bit more about how this goes. Pairs of input and output values are fed into the network for many cycles called epochs. This way, the network learns the relationship between the input and output. This process is called backpropagation. The backpropagation algorithm calculates the difference between the desired and actual outputs, and then adjusts each of the weights slightly so that the next time such an input is encountered, the output will be closer to the desired output. Over many epochs of training, the weights will gradually come to represent the desired input-output relationship characterized by the training set. This completes our introduction to deep learning. Congratulations on completing this module.